Okay, once again, welcome, and right now to the first lecture of the course, and that is HTML. I got a question in Slack that I didn't answer. The window didn't scroll, so I will start off by that one. The oral hearings, is it possible to do those on distance? Yes, it is. Please send us an email in that case, because we need to have someone being prepared on Skype, because then you will be using Skype. But yes, it's possible to do the oral hearings over Skype. You will, however, on the oral hearings, you need your ID, some kind of ID, so we can identify you just on, like, on written exams. And that's when you are on Skype as well. So you need to show that in the Skype or in the webcam. So you need a webcam and you need a mic, of course, and speakers. Okay. So the topic for today before lunch, we will start off by talking about the web as a platform. And after that introduction, we will go into more or less a bit of HTML and HTML syntax. HTML, as I said, isn't that complicated. It's easy to learn. That's why it's been so successful. That's why the web has been so successful, because everybody more or less could start off just trial and error. And it's not like a programming language where you need to get the semicolon at the right place. HTML is really, really forgiving in that sense. And we will look at some stuff like structure and entities and char codes and stuff. But first of all, are all of you familiar with this kind of model? If you are in the third grade, I hope so. I mean, we have some kind of client and server system, and the web is built upon this system, that we have the browser, the user browser that is the client, and then we have the web server as the server. This is the most typical and easy way of seeing things. But of course, when we start to work at the server, we will see that other servers will be clients for our server and vice versa. But in the first part of this course, when we talk about client applications, this is the picture to remember, that the browser is the client, and then we have a server serving the client. We have the requests and the server answers with responses. And of course, if you're in the network community, you know that a lot of stuff happens under the curtain. There will be like DNS requests and a lot of routers probably on the way. So you know that. You probably also, I hope so, but this is like, if you are watching the news, they always mix up the web and the internet. So please don't mix up web and internet. So the web is an application or a protocol or stack of protocols running upon internet, and the internet is the infrastructure. Quite basic stuff, but we need to sell that right now. There is a lot of course, applications on the internet, but the protocols we will focus on in this course are those. So, are you familiar with TCP/IP? Yeah, you know how to, like, you know your way around IP protocol and like how the bits are constructed together and how the packages are managed and stuff. I don't care, because I have the luxury of being on the application layer in the TCP/IP model. So all the protocols we are discussing in this and the next course are at the application layer, are application layer protocols. And the most important one right now is the HTTP protocol, the hypertext transfer protocol, the protocol used to transfer web pages or HTML pages. The HTTP protocol, have you talked a lot about the HTTP protocol as well? Some been mentioned, something like that. Do you know the difference between the 1.1 and 2? No. So that will be the topic for the following course, because there it will be important. The most commonly used today is the 1.1 version, but version 2 is gaining ground. And actually, with version 2, as developers, we need to rethink some of the old truth about how to build web applications, because that protocol is different in some ways that makes it so that we could write applications in another way than we used to do. But for the first course, we will focus on the 1.1, HTTP 1.1, and in the next following course, we will have a look at HTTP 2 as well. So HTTPS, you are probably familiar with HTTPS. So it's HTTP with a secure layer on top, so that we could have a secure communication with the server. If we just go back, like when we built CoursePress 2012 or something like that, then the truth was that, okay, HTTPS, use HTTPS for secure connections, like when you have to log in the user or make a bank transfer and stuff. Otherwise, use HTTP. And that's because HTTPS was resource heavy. So it slowed down the server. This is an old truth. Today, all are agree upon that you should, in more or less always, use HTTPS when you write web applications. If we look at the new APIs that are finding its way into the browser, those APIs often require HTTPS, or else you can't even use the API. And if we look at Google, for instance, they will promote sites that have a secure connection in favor of those who don't. So if you want to be in search engine optimization, it's also important to use HTTPS in that sense. It's a lot of, in the following course that almost none of you will take, we will also look more deeply on HTTPS and implement it on the server and look at certificates and stuff. But in this course, we will touch upon it once in a while. Okay, and then we have the WebSocket protocol as well. That is a really important protocol, which enables us to write real-time applications, to get data to the user. The WebSocket protocol enables online gaming, or multiplayer online gaming, I should say, that you could have really low latency. You don't have low latency in the HTTP protocol, but in the WebSocket protocol, you have really low latency, so you could write real-time applications. We will look at that in the last part of this course. You will implement, people implemented, or students implemented in the last assignment, they implemented online game or multiplayer games. The last time we had this course, so you can. The required application is a chat. So you will make a simple chat in the last assignment that you could use to talk to all other students taking the course. Okay. So this is just the foundation upon what that we have in the background that we will work upon. How many of you used the web in 1993? How many of you were born in 1993? Some were born in 1993. Okay, I was. I didn't use the web because in 1993, I used BBS's bulletin board system. It was the coolest thing back then. Everybody in computer science was calling using a call-up phone to a BBS or bulletin board system and chatting with others and trying to download like ASCII art and stuff. So I kind of missed out on the introduction of the web because I thought, oh, that web thing, that's just another fly on the wall. So I got into the web business in like 96, something like that, 7 maybe. But this one, this web page here is the first web page. Do you know who created the first web page? Do you know his or her name? No, it's hard to do an educated guess as well. It's Sir Tim Berners-Lee. So he kind of invented the web and the HTTP protocol in the 1990s. He worked at the time at CERN down in Switzerland, the big particle accelerator. He was into research and he thought it was a hazard to like book big computers to be able to access research papers and stuff. So he thought of a different system, a distributed system where the scientists could share their research papers with a simple server installed on their computer and using the hypertext markup language. So this one is the first world's first web page. It's still accessible, or a recreation of the original one is still accessible. Looks like this. It's not too unfamiliar, right? You know, you probably, if I ask you what this blue stuff is, you will probably know, right? That is links to other pages. So that we have had that all since the beginning. The only difference between this image and the original one is that the background was probably gray back then, because browsers rendered the background gray instead of white as it is today. Okay, we move forward in time to 94. This is when most early adopters came into the picture and started using the web and making own web pages and publishing them on web servers. And sorry for the Swedish, but doesn't matter in this case. It's an old picture. So you kind of did your My First homepage and you wrote some stuff and you added some pictures of your dog or flowers and you listed stuff using those lists. Those lists were like everywhere. You listed your favorite movies or something like that. And then you published it on the web and hoped for the best. Wasn't a lot of design decisions going into making those web pages. Do anyone remember what happened next? Well, Microsoft, I mean, back from the beginning, we had companies like, or browsers like Mosaic and Netscape Navigator, and Microsoft also wanted to join the scene. They saw that, okay, having a browser could be a fun idea. So they created their web browser, Internet Explorer. And like that, we had different web browsers, so the user could choose a browser. And okay, but Microsoft wanted all the users to go to Internet Explorer, or Mosaic wanted all their users to go to them, or Netscape, as it later became. How to get users to join the platform? Well, we implement fun stuff. Implementing fun stuff means adding the support of animated GIFs or cool background colors, and that lured the developers into their platform. So they kind of like wanted the developers, because if the developers made web pages for Internet Explorer, the users will choose Internet Explorer. Otherwise, you will just get a message saying, oh, to access this web page, you need Internet Explorer. So the result, yeah, something like that. You have probably, some of you, anyone remember those days? Yeah, some of you. I mean, this was the coolest stuff, fire. You should always have fire on your web page. I made a lot of pages with fire. Chandeliers of some reason, I don't know why. Animals running, and the mandatory email sign rotating or something like that. Or under construction builders doing their stuff. The background, of course, should be like an old wallpaper, and it should almost be impossible to read the nonsense on the page. This wasn't what Tim Berners-Lee had in mind when he created the web back in the 1990s. I mean, he saw this great system where information could be linked together, taking the user further and further on. Those things were implemented by Microsoft and Netscape. So what happened was that they got together and said, oh, this is not a good... If we continue this race, this browser war, the web pages will be a mess and no one will be using them. So instead, they got together. They also got together with Tim Berners-Lee, actually, and they all created a consortium called the World Wide Web Consortium, V3C. That consortium is still active today, and Tim Berners-Lee is the head of that consortium. And they are today standardizing most techniques regarding the web. Okay, so stuff, I mean, instead of just being a fan pages showing off the latest technology, companies got into the picture and started to see benefits of marketing their companies on the pages. They started adding content, and when you add content, you need to organize the content in some way. Someone invented frames, and frames are like separate web pages in one web page. So this one is actually three. The first frame is the upper one with my first homepage. The second one is the content, and then we have a menu on the side. The problem was that developers back then had those fancy 13-inch computer screens with a mind-blowing 640 by 380 or something resolution. So they made like pages that were good on their screens, and then users had smaller screens with lower resolution, and the menu didn't fit, and the stuff just broke. Frames were popular back in back then. They are not anymore. Frames is this big no-no. Don't use frames if you don't have a really specific reason to do so. Maybe embedding a YouTube movie or something like that. But other than that, you should not base your design decisions based on frames, because there's a lot of problems with those. Search is one. If you index in a search engine this upper page and the user clicks it, oh, what an interesting page, I want to watch that. They go into that page and the only thing they see is this upper portion here. They only see my first homepage. Oh, where's the rest? Oh, it's on another page somewhere else. Search engines hate it. Disabled people hate it. If you are blind, for instance, and try to navigate using a screen reader, this is just a mess. There are other disadvantages as well with frames. Actually, 10 years ago, a woman came up to me after election and said, on our company, we actually use frames and we have a good reason to do so. It turned out that they were distributing documentation on CD-ROM disks. And when you do that, you don't have a web server to serve those pages. And in that specific application, it was actually a good choice to use frames. And still today, some documentations out there use frames. So, okay, there are always exceptions to the rules, but one rule in this course is don't use frames, and we won't touch upon frames more than this, okay? Yeah, it's spoiler alert. Ah, I did it. Okay, so back to 2003, how did pages look like? Oh, like this again. The full circle. This was what Tim Berners-Lee intended to do, or meant to do. And in 2003, and since, I would argue that all web pages look like this. So we could take whatever web page you want, and we can have a look, and it will look something like this. Do you agree? Do you have a web page that you use? Give me a suggestion. Kodkollektivet. Jag skriver så för det stavar fel. Jag stavar rätt. So, okay, doesn't look a lot like what I said, right? Yeah. What we are talking about in this course is HTML, and that means not using style sheets. That is the lesson of afternoon. So we will we will delete them all. We will remove the CSS and that. Oh, that was commented. That one. No. Oh, they have a lot of stuff. I could have used a plugin to do this instead. But they are not installed. Yeah, but I think we're more or less there. Okay. That's a picture, I guess. The upper part. That's why it looked like that. So, I removed the styling properties. And we just have a look at the HTML code. And okay, we are back, right? We have the lists, we have the headlines, the paragraphs. Looks kind of like web pages back in 1993, and it should do. Because HTML, I said HTML is easy, and it is, because HTML is only producing this, and this isn't hard. How many of you have written a document in Word or Google Drive or Pages or something like that? Oh, I'm surprised. Only half of you have written a document in a word processor. Okay. But if you have written a document in Word or something like that, you will probably recognize this stuff. It's as easy as that. Is there a gap somewhere? Oh, I missed the... We will check in the break. If I do it like this, crackle at time to time. Does it crackle when I do this? I try to... someone has put the mic in the holder the wrong way. No. Okay. Yeah, we will have a go at the break and see what's wrong. Okay, so I would argue that all... If you visit a modern web page, they all look like this. And the most clear example of this is an old page called cnguardian.com. This has been around since 20 years or something like that. But this is a page with the same HTML, just applying different designs. So it's actually the exact same HTML in the background. We are just adding style sheets that makes this page look completely different. So for the first part of the course, we will focus only on making good HTML. And in the next part, or in the next part of the first assignment, we will add CSS and we could make it beautiful. Okay, but it has some other stuff has happened since then. It didn't stop here. I mean, it stopped here. You can say that it stopped in 2003 developing the base of HTML, but since then it's happened a lot. And the most important thing is that there has been a lot of APIs being added to the web browser, programming APIs, so developers can add functionality like sound and videos and interaction with the physical world around us and making use of sensors in your mobile phone and stuff. So that's where the magic has happened since 2003. So today, a modern web page looks something like this. You have the so-called responsive web pages that works in different units, even if you have a big screen or you have a small phone. Whatever, the pages today should work well. Unfortunately, CoursePress doesn't, so please don't try CoursePress on your mobile phone. We haven't actually had time to do a new style sheet for that one. So, but LNU has done a good job since the new launch last fall. Spotify today, you can run Spotify or YouTube or Twitch or whatever media application, Netflix, in your browser. And that's because a lot of new APIs has been presented. So today, I would argue that the web, I mean, back in the days, the web was just an source of information. You used web pages to publish information. Today, it's an application platform. Just like Android is an application platform, iOS is an application platform, Windows is an application platform, I would argue that the web is an application platform today. And in this course, we will not build home pages, so to speak. We won't build like landing pages for a company or something like that. Okay, the first assignment is something like that, but that's just because to get you started with HTML and CSS and not mixing in all other stuff. But in the end, you will build applications and nothing else. So please don't go tell your friends that in this course we build web pages, because we don't. We build web applications, and that's a big difference. And to build web applications today, you need to be developers. Back in the 1990s, everyone could just put together a web page and publish it, and they can do that today as well. But to build an application on the web today, it's just as complicated as building a Java application or a iOS Swift application or whatever. You need to know your APIs, you need to know the stack, you need to know the interactions between all techniques. And that's not easy, because it's a lot of different APIs and different techniques. However, it's a really, really modern application environment today. You have modern techniques, you have really modern APIs, and you have a modern programming language in JavaScript that is one of the newer programming languages. It stems since 1995 or something like that. Okay, Swift is newer, for instance. But you will see that JavaScript is quite a modern language. JavaScript is a really versatile language. You can do like whatever you like in JavaScript. You can write Java-like applications in JavaScript using keywords like extend and stuff and class like you are used to in Java. Or you can go a completely other way and using the more prototype-based features of the language. That makes JavaScript hard as well, because you have a lot of choices to do. It's not like if you're doing an inheritance in Java, it's quite like you do it like this because you have the extend and stuff. But in JavaScript, you can do the inheritance in so many other ways, and you can even argue that, okay, maybe we could have another construction that don't even utilize inheritance, for instance. So, the web as a platform, and this is where I think it gets interesting. You can, this one is clickable, so you can actually go into a page on the MDN, the Mozilla Developer Networks, where they will show off a lot of the modern APIs. So there's a lot of applications here that you can try out. Today you have modern 3D graphics. You have access to the graphic chips on the unit, so you can write games, modern games, using 3D acceleration if you like. You have video support. So you can try out some games in the browser and stuff. If I look at my kids, I have two kids, 7 and 9 years old, and when I was young, we used like Nintendos and stuff for games. If I look at my kids, they have their own computers. Okay, they play a lot of Minecraft. Minecraft is the shit. Oh, it's an American channel, right? I can't say the S word or the F word. I will have to be careful. But the platform they use the most is the web browser. They play online multiplayer web-based games like Diep.io, Agar.io, Roblox, and stuff. They do it in the browser and it's natural for them. They don't care that the graphic isn't like Battlefield compatible in all ways. They just like the platform and it's accessible and it's free and it's open. So for them, the browser will be like this thing that is on every platform. They can use it in the phone, they can use it on the computer. It's like the platform of choice for them. Okay, they will get older. They probably would like a PS4 or something soon. So, no, they changed the back in Chrome. How did they do it on Windows? Alt, arrow. Something that is coming that you have probably had in some of your courses or discussed is Internet of Things, right? Have you discussed it? Yeah. Connecting stuff to your computer, connecting stuff to communicate amongst each other. A problem with that is that they are, in a lot of cases, utilizing their own protocols. Have one protocol for the car, you have one protocol for your light bulbs, you have one protocol to your electricity company, and they can't communicate to each other. So, Uprise is the Web of Things. And the Web of Things is like this layer, the application layer upon the Internet of Things. So instead of the light bulb not being able to talk to the refrigerator, they can use the web to communicate through the web. And there is happening a lot of stuff right now around the Web of Things that will be really interesting. In the newer versions of Chrome, you have Bluetooth support, for instance, so you can actually connect the browser directly to a Bluetooth unit without the need of the underlying the underlying operating system is probably there in some way, but you don't need to configure anything in Windows or Linux or Android, because the browser takes care of the connection to the Bluetooth stuff, so you can actually go to a web page and access your light bulbs directly without going through servers or underlying systems. A lot of things is happening to the web as a platform right now. Okay. The goal for this course is to make web applications and to make web applications that are well structured. We have three tools in our hands. We have the HTML, we have the CSS, and we have the JavaScript. The HTML is the structure. You have seen a simple HTML page. Nothing strange there. The CSS is the presentation, the beauty of the applications. We won't focus too much upon those two layers. If you should be good at writing beautiful applications using CSS, you probably should have some kind of artistic vein in you, or be really, really good in using frameworks that do a lot of stuff for you. I'm not, so my examples will look like real computer science, classical computer science projects. And the JavaScript adds everything else, the behavior of the web pages, the APIs. And of course, that's why we are focusing to 90% on JavaScript in this course, because that's the thing that is interesting. So, yeah, I asked you before, when you had the time to think, how many of you have edited a document in a word processor or like Word? Hands up. No? Not everyone has used Word or Google Docs or no? Okay. I'm not to judge. But this is like, yeah, this is iCloud Pages, but it's the same thing. Okay, so if you edit a document that you all will have to do when you have the final course in the program, at least, because you need to write your thesis. you just construct the document like this. You say this is a headline, you mark it, and you probably go to some kind of drop down menu and mark it as a header or headline. Okay, if you want a list like that, you mark it and you press some buttons and you get a list. That's how you should do it. You should not write the text, mark it, change the font to a bigger size and make it bold just to get a headline, right? Because the next time you're going to do a headline, you need to do it all over again. If you want to do a citation where you want the text to go in like this, how do you do that? You change the margins, I hope. You don't use the space bar to like put everything in like that. No. And that's the same thing in HTML. You don't use presentational stuff to structure the document. It's important that this is tagged as a headline, because when Google visits your page or another search engine, they will see that, oh, this is the main headline of the page. This must be important. If you just alter the font size and make it bold, the search engine will just see a page with all texts alike, and it won't be able to say what's important or what is not important. If you're going to do a list like this, you don't press one dot and make a space. You use the built-in list tools. If you open a Word document today, you have the docx format, right? That's a zip file. So you can rename it to zip.zip and open it like a zip archive. And inside, you will find a lot of XML code. And you will find your text marked up using XML, most likely. So you can actually edit Word documents using your code editor and XML, if you like. And that's because it's the same principle, the HTML and making simple documents. It's the same principle. So before the break, we will just have a look at the time chart for where we are today. As I said, the web was born in the early 1990s, or early 90s. And it didn't have a version number. It was just the web or HTML. In 95, HTML2 came out, and that was a result of this World Wide Web Consortium standardizing it. CSS, adding styles, came in 95 or 96, and then incremental versions of HTML came out. In 1999, the group presented the most classical HTML version of them all, the HTML 4.01. And that was, I had lectures back in the day where I said, I think it was in 2002, I said HTML 4.01. I'm not sure how you say it in English, actually. But where I said that will be the last HTML version. There won't be any more HTML versions. Just forget it. Because in the day, XML had gained popularity. Developers, real developers, not just hobby developers, real developers were creating web pages and web applications. Real developers, like yourself, know that you like strict rules, right? You like the compilator to tell you that you have written something wrong. You don't want the compilator to guess how you want to do stuff. If you write something wrong, you don't want the compilator to just, I make something up and fix this, because then you have no control. So the World Wide Web Consortium, they saw this and said, okay, XML is perfect. XML has been around for a lot of years. Maybe we should make the web be an XML application so that we have those strict rules that we have in XML. If you have written an XML document, you know what will happen if you forget to close a tag or something like that. The document will break. The interpreters that will try to process the document will fail. You will get an error on line 38 saying this tag wasn't opened or something like that. So the World Wide Web Consortium said that from now on, the web will have an XML heading. Making it so that, I mean, one of the successes with HTML was that you can write it almost like what, however you like, and the browser will fix it for you. So even if you write a lot of stuff wrong, the browser will fix it, and you can always work around those fixes. You can't do that in XML, and they thought it was a good thing. So they said the next standard will be XHTML, extendable HTML, forcing those strict rules with draconian error handling. Draconian error handling meaning that if you write something wrong, the application will crash. So if you visited a web page where someone had written something wrong, like missing a semicolon in Java, the web page will crash, and you will have a notification saying, okay, you have an error on line 16. They thought it was a good thing. Not everybody thought that. So actually, some broke out of the World Wide Web Consortium, starting their own path. I think Opera, the web browser, the Norwegian web browser company, was in the lead. And they took a lot of like-minded people from the web, the V3C, with them, and starting to build an alternative path that will build upon HTML4. So while V3C worked on the XML path, and I stood in Kalmar teaching XML and how XHTML should be the new big thing, another group worked on the new version of HTML that later became HTML5, as you know it today. There was a lot of fuss going on between the early 21st century and 10 years later. And finally, I think it was in like, I don't remember, so I shouldn't guess, but somewhere in this area, the groups came together and said, or actually V3C said, okay, forget this XML thing, it won't work. Why won't it work? Because a web page today consists of code from so many different developers. I mean, you can have, if you visit a page today, you will have ads coming in from other networks. If the ad network will add a falsy tag in their ad, the whole page will crash. So Facebook will crash if the ads are not written in the right way. And that wasn't a good thing for the web. So V3C said, okay, we will stop this XHTML and we will join you on the HTML track. And they all came together. They built a new standard called HTML5. It's not a descendant of HTML401. It's a completely rewritten standard, but it's really heavily inspired by HTML1 and some of the good stuff in XHTML as well. In 2014, the standard became a recommendation and finished. HTML5 will never be finished. We are up in version 5.2 right now, and they're keep adding features. But often it's new APIs, so a browser can support the HTML5 specifications but lack support for some of the APIs. That's okay. However, the working group that was this breakout group, they are still there, and V3C is still there. So they have their own, they are supporting the specification in two separate locations, but it's the same specification. But they still have different views on what to call it. V3C like the versions numbers, so they are in version 5.2. The WAT working group said that, okay, we don't need version numbers. It's a living standard. We're adding stuff all the time. So if you look at the standard from the WAT working group, it's called HTML. But the V3C is the HTML 5.2. So that's where we are. You can use either one if you like to check out the standard and look in the documents. Oh, yay. Soon break. I will just show you this one. So because it's a standard, APIs are being added all the time, you need to think about browser compatibility. I mean, will it work in Windows, on Chrome or Firefox, or will it work in Safari, Opera? Hands up, how many on your desktop computer or laptop, how many do you use Chrome? Okay, as the main browser, how many uses Chrome? Okay, how many uses Firefox? How many uses Safari? Internet Explorer? Oh, come on, yeah, good. Did I miss anything? Oprah? Yeah. Oprah and Chrome are more or less the same today, and we will discuss that later. Mobile phones, Chrome, Safari, don't know. Yeah. Okay, so Chrome is, I mean, it looks kind of like the statistics. Chrome is the big one today. But you all need, as developers, to take in account that if you want your application to work all over the place, you need to sometimes hold back on using the newest APIs, because the newest APIs are maybe implemented in Chrome or Firefox or in Safari, depending on who is the main developing team. They are all working together. Microsoft and Apple and Google, they are all working together with the standards. They are no rivalry, not so much anyway. They're working together on this. But the features find their way into different browsers. So if you want to use, for instance, the Box Shadow, it's a CSS technique. Oh, that's the wrong computer. This one. Box Shadow. You can just write in the API name and you see, simple. Okay, in all major browsers today, this works. Opera Mini you could ignore because that's a special case. You see that the global hit rate is 92%. So if you are using Box Shadow, 92% of all of your users will probably be able to use this feature. WebSockets. Oh, wrong. I have too many keyboards. WebSockets. Okay, so WebSockets is quite a stable today. The problem was IE8. So from now on, it's nearly ever a problem anymore. The most of the APIs are really fastly adopted into the browsers. Of course, you have the problem with backward compatibility. If you have a company there sitting on Internet Explorer 6 or 7, okay, they're lost maybe, or you are in the unpleasant position to write an application for that company, okay, then you will have to consult a page like this and see what you can use. But in most cases, you can use most of it. In this course, you're able to push the limits. So if you're web application only works in Firefox because you are utilizing some of the APIs that are not globally available, that's fine. Just tell us so we can use Firefox when you demonstrate the application. But bear in mind that you need to always have some kind of knowledge of what you are using because the APIs are not always implemented. So, I got one question during the break, and it was, can we change the music in the break on the Live Coding TV channel? And yeah, we can. That's the LNU official music, and it's quite boring after a while. So, but we can't use anything copyrighted. So. Okay, let's get down to business. This was an introduction to the field, more or less. I had some worries in the break that some of you said, oh, we are completely new to this. That's fine. We will start at the beginning with HTML. The tempo will be quite high though, so be prepared for that. So this is what you will start out with. This is what you will do. So HTML is documents. It's a simple text document with the ending .html. In the old days, we used .htm, but that was because Windows only could handle three characters in the file ending. So today it's .html. When we write static web pages or static HTML pages, that we will start out with. So you open that document in your favorite editor or IDE, like Eclipse or WebStorm, and you write this code. This is the minimum stuff you should always have in your HTML document. You will notice that if you only write hello and nothing else, and open that page in a browser, it will say hello. And that's because the web browser is doing stuff for you. The browser sees that, okay, this person has no clue what he or she's doing, so I will add the rest. And you will have to rely on that the browser is adding the right stuff for you. So, and we should not rely on the browser, we should rely on ourselves. So you should write all this in the document from the beginning. And we will go over part by part. Okay, so this is not a minimal document. You could actually remove some stuff, but you should not. So we say this is the minimal document. Starting at the top, we have the doc type. I could probably spend a lecture just on the doc type. If we go back, because this line of code was really, really important when we had this browser wars and later on when browsers tried to figure out if you as a developer knew what you were doing or didn't have a clue. So the simple solution was to add something quite cryptical at the beginning of the document. I think this stems maybe from XML or SKIML, which is the language describing XML. So you added some stuff at the top, and the browser said, okay, if this person or developer is adding this stuff, the person probably knows what's going on, so I will trust this developer. If there was nothing, the browser said, okay, let's do the heavy work for them, so they altered stuff. This was called the doctype switching. So when Microsoft implemented stuff, they didn't like the standard at the beginning. They said, oh, we know better than the standard. Okay, so the standard says that we should do the width of an object this wide. Or can I move this one without breaking it? Maybe. Let's try. Okay, we have some kind of window. What is the width of this window? You will say. Would you argue that the width of the window is this one? Or would you argue that the width of the window is this one? It's hard to say, right? Okay, so the standard says that the width of the window is this one. But the engineers at Microsoft thought that that's not like logical, right? The width of the window should be this one. So Microsoft said that, okay, we implement the width like this, and the standard said like that. So in Netscape and Firefox, the width of the object was that, and in Microsoft it was this. And that is a problem for you developers, because you said, I want to make something this wide, and in some browsers this was wider, and in some it was not that wide. So this doc type said that, okay, if you're adding a doc type, we think you know what you're doing. So you are probably coding coding according to standard. So we will use the total or the inner width for width. And if you're not adding something like this, we go into legacy mode or quirks mode and we render it with other Microsoft's specification. So that was the origin of the doc type for using it as for doc type switching. Later when XHTML came by, the doc type switching was more important because you had to add exactly the right tag or else your page wouldn't behave as you were supposing. And even JavaScript APIs wouldn't maybe behave like you like. So you had to write the exactly right doc type. And this doc type is quite complicated. If you capitalize one letter that you weren't supposed to do, it will fall back into the quirks mode. So as a developer, you had to have a browser plugin telling you if you were in quirks mode or in standard mode. So quirks mode was this old mode and standard mode, the new standard mode. So this doc type is the easiest way of triggering standard mode in all modern browsers. So today we see this as the HTML5 doc type. It doesn't say 5, it doesn't say 5.2. It's just we need this one at the top of our documents to trigger standard mode. If we forget it, we might trigger quirks mode. So always add that row in top of your documents. And nothing before it. Don't write comments and stuff before that one. Have it the first character in the document. Okay? HTML or markup. HTML is not a programming language. You cannot say you are programming HTML. You will sound not like a developer. So please don't say that you are programming HTML. You are marking up stuff or writing markup. It's just like the Word document. So if you like something to be a header, you mark it as a header using tags. The first row is some kind of HTML. It's some text that says this is some, and then we have something called a tag, and then we have some content inside of the tag, and that's just text, HTML, it says. And then we have a closing tag or end tag, and then we have some other text. So this is HTML. So we will just look at the terminology here so we say the same thing. So EM, that's an HTML tag. So they look like tags, kind of. And you recognize those from XML if you've used XML. You have what we call a starting tag and an end tag. Some tags are self-enclosing. So we end them, we only write one tag and we add a slash in the end to make it self-closing, like the image tag that we will see soon. Together with the content, the tag, the content and attributes, we call it an element, an HTML element. And elements is what we usually, this is what the API often presents to us. We get elements back. So that's a key thing to knowing that this is an element. You have worked with attributes in Java, right? And attributes and values. It's the same thing here. You write the attributes inside of the start tag, not the end tag, the start tag. You add equals and quotation marks, and then you write your value inside of it. You can use what's called in English, the single quotation marks. They're called something. I don't remember, but you know what I mean. You could use either double or single quotation marks. Okay, down below, which is not visible, it says attribute value. So more in this case is the value. That's quite clear, right? So this is just the terminology. Okay, going back to the document, we have the, the HTML tag. That's a tag enclosing the whole document. In XML, you need to have a root element. And this stems from that you need a root element for your document, and the root element tag is the HTML tag. So it's the first one and the last one. The start tag is the first and the end tag is the last one. Don't forget it. And on the HTML tag, we are adding an attribute, and we are adding the attribute of language. And we are, in this case, sending it to EN for English. Or we could set it to SV for Swedish. But that is what the main content of this page is written in. I mean, the main, if a reader goes to this page, should the reader say that this is content in Swedish, or does he or she say that this is content in English? That's the language you should specify. If you have a site with mixed languages on the same page, you probably still have a main language, and then you have quotes or whatever in different languages, then you can specify those quotes later on. So this is the main for the document.
Yeah, I was thinking about that like when you do like internationalization and localization.
Yep. Internationalization and localization. In that case, that when the web page renders, you are rendering it in one language. So if the Swedish version is rendered, then it should set SV there. And then if the user clicks like show this in English, then the page will re-render, and then it should set EN there, because then you are showing it in English. So always what the user are looking on. Some time ago, search engine users used this one as well to say what kind of language this is written in. So if you are searching on a Swedish profile, you will benefit Swedish results and not from other countries. But I think nowadays, because this has been misused, I think the browsers are learning the language without using that attribute. Okay, moving on to the head. The HTML tag is divided into two sections, the head section and the body section. You can see it right here. We have the head on the top, and then we have an empty body on the bottom. And the head should always be coming after the HTML starting tag. So inside of the head tag is often empty like this. We don't set any attributes on that one. We have a meta tag and a title tag. And those are mandatory. You should always add those. The first one is telling the browser what character set you have been using when you develop this page, or what character set the web server is serving this page in. Because you have different character sets. This was more usual back in the days where not all were using Unicode, for instance. Today, I would recommend using UTF-8 because it's so widely spread, and all browsers implement it, of course. But if you're sitting on a Windows computer, you might, and it's not you are not able to see it, but it says Windows 1252, and that's a character set built into Windows that Windows sometimes forces upon developer tools. For instance, if you're using Visual Studio, it will probably default to Windows 1252. That is quite equal to ISO 8859. And ISO 8859, -1, is a character set used often in Western Europe, in Sweden and other Western Europe countries. And you can use ISO 8858-1 if you like, but then you have to specify it here as well. So you need to check in your IDE or your code editor what it says you have, which kind of character set you have. So you can force the page to be written in UTF-8.
What is the
char set? That's how characters are coded on a bit level. So how, what, I mean, you have the ASCII table, for instance, where an A is coded in a certain way, and a B and a C, and so on. And the order in how the characters are ordered in the ASCII table. And UTF-8 is another implementation of that, that tells how the characters are coded on a underlying level. Yeah, I mean, if you are writing, if you are pressing the keyboard for a T, depending on if you are using UTF-8 or ISO 8859-1, depending on which one you're using, that the character will be coded in different ways. So when that bytecode are sent to the browser, if you pressed T, the browser should present the T to the user. But if the user have a different char set, and the browser think that you wrote this in another char set, it might present a whole other character. So the most common use, because A, B, A to Z, they are in the same place in more or less all the character sets we use. So you won't show any difference there. But when you're using Swedish characters like O, Ä, then those will be like weird question marks and stuff. Then you know that, okay, I have some problem with the character sets. And that's really, really common in web applications, that you're reading from some site and you're not paying attention to what character sets the byte streams are coming in, and you get wrong signs. I mean, if you who are from Sweden that have O, Ä, Ö in your names, you have probably been there a lot of times that those have been in some system coded the wrong way. And that's because of character sets. You don't need to think of it so much. Make sure that your development tools use UTF-8 and say UTF-8 here. Then you should be fine. If you are using special characters and they don't show up as you like, then investigate, because then you have mismatch between the character sets. Fire alarm in Kalmar. And that means that we have no cameraman, because, yeah. Exciting. So I'm on my own for a while anyway. Okay. No, not okay. Character set, always add it. Add a title to the web page. The title is the one you see in the tabs in the browser. So the title of your web page. Any idea why we should add the meta tag before the title and not after? It's just because it's good to tell the browser what characters you're using before you're using them. The browser should be able to detect it anyway, but it's good practice to put them in this way. And then we go down to the body. And the body of the document, that's where you write the code that the user will see. So everything inside the body tag, it's what will show up in the browser window. Okay, what should we put there? We should put blocks. When you're building web pages, you're building blocks. You're adding blocks. If you're adding a header, you're adding a block with a header. It's the same thing back to the Word document. If you're writing a header, you can't write a paragraph to the left or to the right of the header, right? You need to start the paragraph on a new line. It's the same thing here. If you write the headline will take up all the space of that are available in the browser window. And if you write a paragraph, it will start at the far left and it will continue all the way to the right. So what the code or the tags you will write will be boxes like this, except some elements called inline elements. Inline elements are like those blue boxes. They like go inside of big boxes. And those are typically like if you want to emphasize a text or make a text important, you use some tags for that. And those don't make up blocks, because it would be ridiculous if the text were like this, and then just because you want to emphasize something, it will go down on a new line and in a new box. So inline elements, like making emphasizes and stuff, they are not on boxes. Images is one inline element. Links are inline elements. Headers, paragraphs, lists. You see a list here. Lists, they are boxes. And in this case, we have the list. We are saying that we want the list, and the list will be a box or a block. And inside the block, we say that we have list elements. So every line is the list element, and they are their own boxes inside the outer box or block. So this is the block and the inline elements. In HTML5, they introduced a much more complex model around this, with not just block and inline elements that we had before, but with a lot of different kind of elements. Just grouping those in different elements, and they one element can be different groups as well. No need to worry about that in this course, because you don't have any benefit of knowing those groups. The only thing which is relevant still is knowing what the block and an inline element is. So we focus on that. Okay, making a structure for a web page. This is a quite classical structure, right? We have the web page, we have some kind of header, the blue one, we have some kind of navigation, we have a main part or content part of the page divided into maybe articles, news articles or whatever. We have some kind of extra on the side, some menu, some cloud or with words or some related stuff, ads. So this is quite a typical web page. Now they are writing that they are mixing it from the parking lot, so that's good to know. Sorry. Okay, if we convert this image into HTML, it would look like something like that. In classic HTML, we would use something called div tags, and div tags are container tags. Div tags don't have a semantic meaning. They don't mean anything. They are just tags used, or element used, to group stuff together. So this was what we had in HTML4, in XHTML. This is classic web development back then. So we wanted a header, then we added a div tag and said this is a header. We wanted navigation, so we added a div tag and we set an ID on that div tag to navigation or nav. But those values, they are up to the developer. So in Sweden, I mean, the nav wasn't so commonly used. You may be used menu. And in other parts of the world, other words were used. This is a problem. Once again, a big problem for search engine optimization. You know who is big in search engine optimization? Or search engines? Yeah, Google. Google have their own browser. Why do you think they want a known browser? Because they want to be able to influence how the HTML standard should work, so that they could benefit from knowing more. Because this is not a good model for a for a search engine. For the search engine, it's really important to know that this top part is the head of the page, and that this yellow part is the navigation. Because then the search engine knows that, okay, the header is important, it's what the page is about. This content part is what I should index. When I'm done, I could use the navigation to go to next page and index that one. This on the side, the ads, I don't need to index that, I don't need to care. The problem with this model, every developer has their own keywords for telling that something is a news article or that something is a header. It might say huvud in Swedish web pages. So it's really hard to build search engine optimization against this page because it has no semantic meaning for a computer anyway. So in HTML5, they introduced a new model that is that is more semantically correct. They introduced tags for specific parts of the page. So we have the header tag telling this is the header or a header. We have the nav tag telling this is the navigation of the page. We have the main tag telling this is the main part of the content. We have articles telling this is separate articles upon this page. We have an aside that says this information is only related. It's not critical for that page, it's only related information. And we have the section tag that we can use to divide into different sections. So this adds semantics to our web pages, and that's why we are supposed to use those and not this older model. I will show how to write it in code just a moment. Questions about this? I won't go into detail on every one of those tags. You will need to have to do that on your own. I expect you to know how many headers you can have on a page. I expect you to know how many main elements you can have on a page. One. You can only have one main element on the page, but you can have several headers. You can have headers on each article, for instance, which is quite logical that an article has a header and a footer. There is a footer as well. I didn't add it, but there is a footer tag, and an article can have a header and a footer, which is quite common that in the header you have the headline and maybe the published date, and in the footer you have the author, for instance. So this is telling and feeding the search engines, and not only the search engines. I mean, the web today is interpreted by machines to a large extent. Often we have those great REST APIs, so we as developers can consume data easy, but not always. And if there are no APIs, we like it if there are structured web pages that are easy to interpret. Okay, so this one corresponds to this code. So we are inside the body. I have excluded the top and the bottom part of the web page. You have to add that. But we are inside the body. And inside the body, we have a header, start tag and end tag. We have a navigation. We have a main. We have the aside. Inside the aside, we have the sections. And inside the main, we have three articles. It's the same thing as this one. We have just mentally put those in another way just to, mock up the page. But when we write HTML, we should not think about layout. We should only think about semantics and logics. So this is the most semantic way of doing it. Why? Yeah, because the header is at top. So even if the page would have the header in the center, we should add the header tag to the top because that's the most semantically correct way to do it. If the navigation should be at the bottom of the page for some reason, we should still add the nav tag after the header because disabled people using screen readers would like to have maybe the navigation close at hand. We should not add the navigation between the main and the aside, for instance. We should have it near the top. And then the main content of the page should always come before the aside content, the content that is less important. So the less important content, the lower on the page. So even if the aside should be to the left of the main content, you should have this order. Okay, questions? This is the page that we just watched. If we take a look, inside, we see that we have this document. It's exactly the same that I showed. The only thing I've added is a style sheet to visually show this. Otherwise, it would be just a blank page. So in the CSS, I've added those. I've added the text just to make it more visible. So we see that the body encloses the whole page or the content. We have the header up here. We have the navigation. We have the main. We have the aside. And we have a footer at the bottom, that which I added. And you see that those are blocks. As I said, they follow along with the width of the page. So this is, HTML isn't more complicated than this. So this is what you do in HTML. You just add boxes like this. Yep.
The reason when you were resizing the window, you handle it in HTML or CSS?
No, that's handled right now by itself. Because the block will fill the page, and if you render or re-render the browser, the block will follow. But as we will see when we come to CSS, you will be able to with something called media queries, get information about the width. So you can make a choice as a developer saying that, okay, if we have a smartphone-sized window, we should show this layout instead of this one. But from the start, it's quite responsive. Yeah.
So if it's automatically done, so what was the part?
So one of the requirements in the first assignment is that the page could be resizable. Yes, it shall be. But when you start mixing and matching, and with CSS adding columns, then you have to do some work to still make it flexible. And flexible often means that, okay, maybe the menu or navigation will have a set width, and the content will be flexible.
If you're using this structure, then it will be good for disabled people, like for screen readers.
Yeah. So this is a preferred structure for screen readers. Yeah. I won't talk a lot about accessibility, but it's a topic I hold dearly. So back in the days, it was like you had to add accessibility to web pages. But today, if you are following standards and following guidelines, accessibility is built into the standard. So by following standard, we are also making web pages accessible. Web pages should always be accessible, web applications as well, but it's harder to make web applications really, really accessible. But it's possible. And there are complete standards around that as well. And guidelines. There are guidelines of making accessible web applications. I will probably touch into it, at least, in the next part of the course. Okay. Back. The same template, but I've filled it with information. So it's the exactly same template, but we see what's happened when we fill it with typical information. We have a headline in the header. We have a list in the navigation. Making navigations, I prefer using lists, and most people do, because it's easiest. So it's a good choice by starting out. If you have links to other web pages, organize them in lists, because it's easier to manipulate using CSS. And I have added articles. I've added headers inside of the articles and footers inside of the articles, as I said. So an article should be seen as you should be able to take an article and publish it somewhere else. So it should have its own content, header, footer. It should be a unit. If you have a RSS flow in your on your page or RSS stream setup, this is probably going to be included in the RSS stream. And if we look at the code, there is not much going on, but we can see that, okay, inside the header I added the H1 tag. I won't be able to go through all of the tags. I have written links on the course webpage on which tag it's, I think it's a good start. H1 or the H tags, the header tags are a great start. So this is the main headline of the webpage. We have a list. We see that we have a UL. It stands for unordered list. And in the unordered list, we have three list elements. Each element has an A element inside of it, making it a link. So this is pretty much, I mean, pretty much the first assignment is this one. And the tricky part is adding CSS, basically. So HTML easy, CSS hard. Duh. Harder. Okay, couple of minutes more. You have in Java, you have the just-in-time compiler or whatever it's called that compiles your code and checks for errors, right? So you know when you missed the semicolon. In the HTML world, this is called a validator. It's a good practice to use validators, especially if you're new to HTML. If you're really experienced, maybe you use them once in a while just to check so you don't make any mistakes. But when you're new, it's quite good to like try out your page in the validator. Let's see. Back up. I should just do it like this. I will copy my example. So I copy the link to that one. And we will go into the validator. So this is the World Wide Web Consortium validator. There are many out there, but this one is mine, I almost said. But this, not mine. This validator is, I mean, by the standard committee, so use it. There are often validators built into to the development tools as well, if you like. But I validate my page. Has a long address. Document checking completed, no errors or warnings to show. Use the HTML parser, externally specified character encoding was UTF-8. Okay, so this page is good for me. Okay, so if I make a mistake, if I change something, if I make accessibility errors, like forgetting to add alternative text to images, which is mandatory, then this one will scream and say, oh, you forgot this. The page will show just fine, but it will still warn you that you have some problems with your page. And that's the beauty and the beast with HTML, that it will work even if it's not correct. And that's why it's a good practice to check it using a validator. Okay, I have some slides, not too many, I think. Okay, this is just a list of block and inline elements that are like something to start with. Div tags, p tags is paragraph, it's paragraph tags. H1 to H6 is the headers. Lists, we have a header and a header group. You have to read up on those yourself. We have the footer, main, aside, and a lot of other tags, and there are several more. I will show you where to find them. We have, on inline elements, we have the image for showing images. We have the A tag for making links, or anchor tag, links. We have EM and strong for emphasizing and making a strong point in our text. We actually have the B and the Y. Anyone who does not agree that those shouldn't be here? B and the Y? The B and the I? Oh, well, they were out some time ago, and now they are back. They are more or less back of legacy reasons because people use them. They are completely okay to use nowadays. They have a new semantic meaning. Before, they meant bold and italic. But bold and italic is style, right? It's just saying something should be stronger, or something should be bolder, or it should be curved, or what's it called? Skewed, or yeah, italic. It has no semantic meaning whatsoever. If I were here and I were to say a B word, how should I do that? How should I communicate to you that this is written in bold text? I can't. How should I do with a strong tag? Strong tag has the same visual effect. It will show bold text. But the strong tag has some meaning to it. B and Y has new meanings in the new standard. It's a lot of bogus, so you have to read up on them yourself. But if you're using those, you should also be able to tell me why. And you should be able to refer the standard if you're using the B and the I. Those were very commonly used back in the days, but you probably shouldn't use them. You are probably better off with the EM and the strong if you don't have a specific reason. Okay. When you have written your first HTML page, you need to publish it somewhere. You can, if you're on your local machine, you can just double-click it, open it in a browser, and watch it how it looks. So that's a good first step when you're starting to develop HTML pages. But the next step is to publish somewhere, so it's visible over the web using a URL that you're all familiar with. In this course, you will publish the assignment on GitHub, because your code will be on GitHub and your assignment repo will have something called GitHub Pages connected to it. So when you push your code to your repo on GitHub, it will be automatically published, and you will have this address. You will have the 1dv525.github.io. Then you will have your username dash, no, what's it called? Is it called dash or is dash? Is it called dash?
Yes, dash.
Dash, yeah. Dash examination dash one. So if you, after you have pushed your code to GitHub, if you go to that address, your web page will be shown there for public. In the next parts, the development environment will be a lot more complicated than this, but we will get to that. So in the first part, you can, as I said, you can start a new text document, name it to something.html, write your HTML code, save it, and make sure to push it to GitHub, and then you have completed the first assignment. Okay, you need to add some CSS as well. But that's after the lunch. You know that you need to indent your code, right? I hope you all indent your Java code in a good manner. You all have maybe your different styles. Maybe your IDE will help you indenting your code. This shouldn't be any news for you that you need to indent, because otherwise it's horrible to read. You can indent HTML code in a slightly different ways, but this is kind of like something I use. Others will argue that this in the paragraph should be right after the paragraph, fine. As long as you are consequent that you use the same style all the time. The main part differs between if you're using tab characters or space, or if your tab characters are converted to space characters. I don't care how you do it in the first assignment, but in the second and the third, you will have guidelines, you will have coding guidelines telling you exactly that I think you will have to use two spaces. And the guidelines will be picked up by the development tools you have, so you probably don't have to think about it, because the tool will fix that for you using those guidelines. But using coding guidelines is really important. It's something you will all use when you go out in the industry, wherever you are. Even if you're working with Java or whatever, you will have coding guidelines. So in this course, we have coding guidelines for part 2 and 3 that we need you to follow. You don't need to agree on those guidelines, but we don't care. You need to follow those guidelines. Then after the course, you're free to make your own guidelines. I think our guidelines will be either Airbnb guidelines, from the company Airbnb or Google's. We haven't decided yet. They are really similar. HTML entities. Okay, so if you want to make a larger and less than character, you need to encode those. Search on HTML entities and it will tell you how to do that. I forgot to write this slide, so that's why. HTML comments looks like this. Less than bang dash dash. And then you write your comment on multiple lines, and then you have a dash dash greater than to finish the comment. You need to just make sure that those comments are visible in the HTML page. So if a visitor looks in the source code, they will see those comments. Don't write the password for the database or whatever in those comments. Don't ever write passwords in comments, but yeah, especially not in HTML comments. Okay, where should I find information? You shall find information at the Mozilla Developer Network. So Mozilla, the company behind Firefox, they have excellent developer resources. They have, I mean, you can go to the standard. You can go to the World Wide Web Consortium and read in the standard. It's quite good, but it's quite dry as well. Mozilla Developer Network has better references and they are easier to grasp. So I recommend those always. In the HTML5 rocks, this is quite a good page for just getting into the community, reading about HTML topics in general. But if there are two links you need to, or one you need right now, it's this one, to the HTML element reference on the MDN network. Here you have all the tags. Okay, what's a BR tag? Click it and you get examples and you everything you need. Links to the standard. So make use of that one. What you should not use is the lower one. If you Google header in HTML, on first place you will find V3 schools. It's not that bad anymore. It was really bad once in a time because this is some kind of private organization making money off selling certificates to people thinking that V3 schools must have something to do with the V3C, the organization, so this is probably legit. So this has gained a lot of momentum and shows up high in the search engine results. You could write v3fools.org instead and see why you shouldn't use it. You are allowed to use it, but have some critical eyes when you use V3 schools because there can be errors. Of course, there can be errors in the Mozilla Developer Network as well, but this is where the developers hang, and this is where the not developers hang. So you make your choice self. But if you Google, you will probably end up with this in first place and Mozilla Developer Network in the second. Whoa, that's a lot of information, right? That's all I have to say about HTML. So there's a lot of things up to you now to study. I have her links on the course webpage. So start reading up and start trying. You don't need to dive into the assignment right away. You can just create an HTML document and start testing, and then you can kind of lean towards the assignment. Okay? Questions so far? Yeah. If you place the navigation in this example below the main content, will the screen readers pick it up still? Yeah. And actually, I think there is a debate going on if you should actually put the nav lower. There is a problem with screen readers having it at the top. And that's because when okay, so you have to think yourself into the, close your eyes, and then you listen to the web page, basically. Someone reading the web page for you. if you navigate to this web page, then you get a clear picture of the navigation because you will get what it's about. And then the content will be read for you. And then you say, oh, now I want to go to the next page. So you click in the navigation to the next page. What will happen? Yeah, the navigation will be read for you once again. And that's quite boring. I mean, if you're using the nav tag, the screen readers today are so smart that they will know this, so that they won't even tell you the nav tag. But a couple of years ago, that was a problem. And then they recommended to put the nav tag at the bottom, just to make it easier for disabled people. But nowadays, the screen readers should be so smart, so if there are a nav on the page, they will pick it up. Yeah. But there are always two sides of things. Yeah.